Thanks for coming. My name is Clay Eales. I'm the executive director of the Southwest Seattle Historical Society. And I have a longtime friend here, and I've got somebody who can tell when I'm lying. I've got a perfect group here. I've got somebody who helped me put up the ad for Marquee last week. What a crowd.
No, I only took it down.
Well, we had to put up the movies. Anyway, this is a mural tour here tonight. I hope most of you saw the pictures. You're going to see 8 of the 11 murals. One is too far down. It's at Morgan Junction. We can't walk that far. One is in the old Healing Brothers Ford building, and it's gone. We'll talk about that. And one is just plain gone, and we will talk about that. My aim here tonight is not just to do, let's look at the pretty murals. I wanted to give you the background of this project, but I also want to provoke some thought. I want you to go home and wake up at 3 in the morning with a light bulb in your head. I want you to be thinking about not just what is and what was, but what can be, all right? The murals, how many of you read about this on the blog? How many of you read about this in our email blast? And did any of you read the little essay that I wrote? Okay, nobody, that's okay. You can go back to the website and do that. The Murals of West Seattle is the name of a project that was created by Earl Cruzan back in 1989 to 1992, but it had its real germ with vacations that Bonnie Bierman here, and Mo Bierman, her husband, took with Earl and Virginia Cruzan. You guys went to Long Beach and Owaco?
That's correct.
But the real, oh, where did I put it? Can you ask Laura to go get the orange bag in there? Because I don't want to lock that up tonight. There are booklets from Chemainus, the town of Chemainus in BC. If you've never, and you've probably never heard of it, it's an hour drive north of Victoria. And what it is, thank you. What it is a city, a little lumber town that died, nearly died. And the way that they revived themselves was that they created a bunch of murals and they became a tourist town, the city of murals. And I've been there several times, but more importantly, Earl and Virginia and Mo and Bonnie went there and you were blown away and you said, basically, why can't we do this in West Seattle? And many of the muralists who contributed to this project are muralists for West Seattle. And basically, Earl was the Pied Piper. He was a retired businessman here. He was in charge of what was called the Junction Development Committee. And here's where you can tell me if I'm lying.
No, that's true.
Mo was an ace commercial artist. He volunteered for our organization, making the Save the Admiral signs the night it closed. He'd done many, many other projects, and he was kind of the assistant muralist for all of these, and it takes a village. But those two were at the core of it. It takes somebody with vision to make this happen. And very quickly, think about it, in 3 years, we had 11 historic murals. Basically, what Earl did is he went looking for walls and money. That's what it comes down to. Where are the blank walls, and where's the money? My role was, I wouldn't say it's peripheral, but I was not at the core of it. He assembled a team of people. And at the time, I was president of the Historical Society and having just come off being editor of the West Seattle Herald and White Center News when we produced a book. How many of you have West Side Story at home? It's a great doorstop. I don't know what door you're holding up with it, but it's our Bible of West Seattle history. And we still have copies for sale at the museum. So there was a kind of a rise of interest in history in West Seattle. And capitalizing on that, here comes Earl and Mo, and we provided the photos that these murals were drawn from. And I'm one of the few people left standing. I mean, Earl is still around, but he's not in the best of health. So as we go and tour these murals, please know that I've got Earl Cruzan on my shoulder and that he really is the patron saint of this project. It would not have happened without his vision and his leadership, and my hat's off to him. I don't want to take you for more than an hour, so let's go quickly. We're going to go mural by mural by mural. We'll talk at each one, okay?
Yeah.
Let's go. An example of looking for walls and money. Jack Menasche of Menasche Jewelers owns this building. He was one of the generous building owners who contributed to this project. The subject matter of this, each one of these murals has something unique or unusual about them. And I hope that some of these details will make you smile. There are things that you probably didn't know about them.
Thank you.
This is depicting the Hayu Parade. We call it the Hayu Parade, but it's called really the Grand Parade. And Hayu is the festival. And every year, the local Hayu organization puts together a float. This was in the early 70s of 1973, I believe. And the theme of this year's float for Hayu was the Wizard of Oz. Now, of course, this was drawn from photos, but Lanny Little really created this, pieced this together in an unusual way, because all of these people who were here were never gathered together at one time. They are real people, but he took West Seattle leaders and people off the street and painted them into the mural. And this is one of two of the murals that we have that were redone. This was in 1992, and then it was refurbished in 2007. That's why it's in such great shape now, although we have a blemish here that I can't quite explain. Anyway, there are people I know. There's Earl Grusin. There's Maura Lawless. There's Mo and Bonnie Bierman. Recognize Bonnie? Here she is. One of the problems was, when they redid it, some of the people who were depicted in this mural are not happy with how they were re-depicted.
Well, he did a photograph of me that Mo gave him from 1968 or something like that.
You're forever young.
Yeah.
Now, the other thing about this mural that I just love is that this is the only mural that is on the wall of a building that it depicts. Look at it. It's a perfect depiction of the post office building. It's almost kind of spooky how perfect it is. Even the weather spots up there. And you've got Holy Rosary in the background.
And hot wire.
That's right, the hot wire. By the way, our Junction Historical Survey, you know about this. It was released in March. Raise your hand if you recognize this. That complex of buildings is one of the B's on the list. We have six B's, buildings that are potentially landmark. That's potentially eligible with some more research for landmarking. That's a tangent, but we're talking history here. Any questions before we move on?
I have one. So when these murals were done,
yes.
Was there a particular reason they were done at the time, like 25 years ago or whatever? Was there some sense of change in West Seattle?
I think the answer to that, it's not self-aggrandizing to say this, we did this landmark history book called West Side Story.
Okay.
It came out July 1st of 87. Nearly killed me. I almost lost my marriage too, you know. I mean, we put out the paper every week in addition to doing this book, but it is still a landmark book. It's really our reference for West Seattle and White Center history. And there was a lot of interest generated in that. And then you get Earl and Mo and their wives going up to Chemainus and down to Long Beach and seeing these gorgeous murals and getting inspired and putting two and two together. I think that was it. And Earl had recently retired. So he had some time. He threw his heart and soul into this. It takes a leader with some vision and passion.
Well, Dr. Arlo Bonney.
Orlo Bonney of the West Seattle Chamber, yes. Former principal at Madison, yes.
Well, actually, I was going to say that I grew up in West Seattle. When I was a kid, the parade was the grand parade at night.
Uh-huh.
And it started at like 8 o'clock at night, and then it got dark. And so I don't know if you know why they switch it to becoming a parade.
I'll have to look into that. I don't know.
Okay. I don't know. Because I always thought it kind of made it.
She's asking why it moved from nighttime to daytime. I don't know.
About downtown parade or West Seattle?
Somebody once told me that the kindest thing you can tell anybody is, I'll get back to you.
I was actually in the parade. My father was in the parade. We were in the parade. It was very exciting as a kid. I was like first grade or something.
Okay, just so you don't get cold and that we get you back here in time, we got a scoop. So we're going down the street. See, this is the second mural we will see tonight. These murals, you ought to know, we're going on a circle tour. It's just to make it convenient to be a route. it's not chronological. So it's not the second mural that was done. This was one of the middle ones. This was done by Alan Wiley. He was one of the more fun muralists. He was cracking jokes all the time. And he's from, oh golly, Bonnie, help me.
He's from Canada.
Yes. And so that helped too. He was very comfortable making fun of things. And this is called Bank Day. This is a real thing. This happened. People of a certain age remember that when you came to school, in every week you would bring your pennies in to deposit them. And of course, this is on the wall of the former Washington Mutual Bank. And Ms. Chilberg is a real teacher. The thing to know about these is that these were painted from real photographs. Most of them, the process, there weren't, you know, computers were not big in that time. What they would do is they would paint a model and then put it onto to photograph and put it onto a,
a projector thing.
Into a grid.
A projector. And they would project it,
overhead
projector. Yeah. Why couldn't I remember the word overhead? And they would project it onto the building and then trace it from that.
There are several ways of putting them on. This one was done that way.
Yes. Yes. And we'll see one that wasn't at all. The beauty of this, there are lots of things to point out. One thing to point out is that speaking at the opening ceremony for this mural, and there was an opening ceremony for each one that featured the artist and other people who were involved. The main speaker was Joanne Schmitz-Fulton, who's no longer with us, with the Schmitz family. This is her as a very young girl. And she's waiting in line to deposit her pennies. And I don't remember, is it her dad, her uncle, Dietrich, who was the president of Washington Mutual Bank?
Schmitz.
Of course, we're talking history here. There is no longer a Washington Mutual, we all know.
But there's still a Schmitz Park.
There is a Schmitz Park and a Schmitz Park Elementary School. I want you to come
and Chilberg Street.
And Chilberg Street is down off of Alki, a very tiny little street where the very first school in Alki was. And please come down to this corner. This is one of the subtleties, and it's a faded subtlety. Oh, yeah, now the process for this was beautiful. You know the cliche about the process and the product. The product's no good if the process isn't any good. These murals just didn't poof appear on the wall. You got to know these muralists and see this take shape over 5-6 weeks' time. And you could come up and talk to the muralist. And sometimes people would come and talk them to death. And they wouldn't get the work done. So Mo Bierman ran interference. He became the in-between guy. And he was a talker too. So he was a match for anybody. And the muralists loved him because of that he could run interference. And they all paid tribute to him in different ways. Alan paid tribute to Mo. Remember in the days when you would carve your name on a desk? M-O-E. It's right here.
Love it.
So we could move along. Any questions about this? Did you all hear Bonnie? A muralist is not necessarily a good technical artist. And Mo was a master commercial artist. And you're saying that he painted all the letters and the numbers and the handwriting.
So they didn't have to worry about it.
Yep. Let's go. We've got more to see.
Yes.
This was down on Alki.
Okay. So it was Alki.
And you said that was one of the Schmitz's?
This is Joanne Schmitz-Fulton. She was Joanne Schmitz then. But you can't see half the mural because of the cars. But the cars move in and out, and eventually you see them. I'll talk about the content of this first. This is obviously titled The Old Mud Hole. Those of you who've been around West Seattle for a while know that this was the predecessor of Coleman Pool. And this was a city-regulated mud hole that once it got too contaminated, they would let the water out and then they'd bring the new water in.
Wow.
This is at Williams Point at the tip of Lincoln Park. And this is based on a photograph, a black and white photograph, so all of the color is the interpretation of Mike Swab, the the murals. Everything in the photo is in the mural, or everything in the mural is in the photo, except for this guy over here with the umbrella. That's an addition, a piece in the foreground to give it perspective. The thing, to, I mean, there are several things about this. One is this is the most horizontal format of the murals, and that's because that's was the nature of the photograph. And this also is very timely because this summer, July 4th, less than a month from now, we're coming up on the 75th anniversary of Coleman Pool, which this was the predecessor of. And I filmed a few weeks ago, and you'll see it if you watch the blog or our website, I filmed Jean Carroll, who is 89 years old. I filmed her in front of this mural and took her down to Coleman Pool. She, along with a friend who lives up in Shoreline, were the first two women as a tandem diving act to dive into Coleman Pool when it opened on July 4th, 75 years ago. She's going to be at the ceremony on July 4th. And so she was able to tell me what it was like to dive into this pool. This mural really depicts it. So this is a good example of depicting something that isn't here anymore. And so how many of you have been to Lincoln Park and walked around where Coleman Pool is?
Oh, yeah.
Now that you know the background of this, I'm just going to be a little philosophical for a moment. This is why it's so cool to have a historical society and for you to get involved in it. Because I really believe that if you love where you live, then the Historical Society is going to be the organization that lets you know why you love it. And every one of you is here for different reasons. Everyone's connected to this area for different reasons. But I guarantee that all of you, the reasons have to do not with you, but with what somebody who came before built for you. Why you were attracted here, why you were brought here, or why you continue to stay here. And so the Historical Society is the one that really binds you to your community and makes you you know, makes you a better citizen. I think it makes you a happier person because you feel like you know your home. And so these murals are a way to tell that you're home. This was part, you know, maybe he didn't articulate it that way, but I'm sure that was in Earl's brain. Yeah. Question.
How was it funded to refurbish that?
Walls and money? This was not refurbished.
Oh,
it's
not?
This is painted in 93, it says. I got to get my facts straight. Not 92, 93. This hasn't been refurbished yet. This is on a north wall. Just like the Bank Day mural is on a north wall, these have not faded as much. The elements are much harder on other directions of walls, and we're going to see that in our next mural. Some of these murals are painted right on the building, some are painted on materials that are affixed to the building. Yes?
Are the pool Colemans the same as the dock Colemans?
Yes, C-O-L, no E-M-A-N, Coleman Dock, Coleman Pool. The Lawrence Coleman family. I call it West Seattle's non-gated community down south of the ferry dock that's called Laurentide, named for Lawrence Coleman. On to the next mural. This was chronologically the first mural. This was done in 1989, just a couple of years after the book. And Bill Garnett was the muralist. And the soft spot in my heart is it's hard to be the first of anything, right? And when you're doing something like this, you don't know if there's going to be a second or a third. And so I think you can tell with this that we were trying to capture a lot in one piece. This is a collage. Most of the murals are not a collage. They depict one scene and try to get a lot of things into it. This is truly a collage, and it has to do with transportation. Modes of transportation that don't exist anymore. And the showcase, the dominant image right in the middle, is an example of how West Seattle really had a lot of cool firsts. We were the destination for the very first ferry boat on Puget Sound. And where you've taken the water taxi is right where the ferry boat came in. Its maiden voyage was Christmas Eve of 1888. This ferry was called the City of Seattle. And it was there, not as a public service, but for a purely commercial purpose, because there was a company over in downtown called the West Seattle Land and Improvement Company. Does that resonate with anybody today? And they were wanting to get people over to West Seattle. Even in that day, 1888, it was cheap. It was 5 cents to come on the ferry. And when you came across on the ferry, how many of you have been on the cable cars in San Francisco? We had an identical cable car system that went up Ferry Avenue, very steep Ferry Avenue, and took a loop all around the Admiral District so that you could look at lots that were selling for $200 a piece. You see, all of the development in the first 40 years of West Seattle was along the water. And up here, it was woods and swamp, and you know, the junction started as a swamp. So to get people up there and to get them interested, they had to transport them. So this is very key to our area's development, but it also was the first ferry on the Sound. And maybe some of you don't know that we've had state ferries for a long time, but they didn't come in until 1950. Before then, there were all these competing shipping lines. Bonnie, you remember.
The Black Ball.
You don't remember? Weren't you about 2 years old in 1950?
There was the Black Ball line.
Yes, the Black Ball line.
Be saying about it.
And we're going to talk about that with a later mural. Anyway, other things. Let's go clockwise. The upper right is the same. Again, these are from photos. This is the same vehicle, the City of Seattle Ferry, coming into dock. Down below is an indication of how things were growing in West Seattle. In 1907, they put on a new ferry called the West Seattle. These ferries came off the line in the 20s. But these two ferries were the main way to get across here while they were fiddling around with the bridge a little further south. Then we come over here to the upper left. This is another first for West Seattle. That's the streetcar. We had a city of our own from 1902 to 1907. And we were the first city in the country to have a city-owned streetcar system. And it came, once the cable car came off in 1897, a couple years later, about 1902, the streetcar came up what is now California Way, and down California Avenue, by bit, every year, until it got to Alaska. And by 1907, the Fauntleroy line had come from Seattle. 1907, the year we annexed to Seattle. And where those two lines intersected, the Fauntleroy line went south, down past the Kenny home, commercial here, we've got a home tour in 2 weeks at the Kenny home, past Lincoln Park and to a little community called Endo Line, end of the line. But where those two joined, right over here, and we'll walk past it when we go back, that's what made the junction. And they called it the Junction, starting in 1907. And then this photo is obviously from looking south to Duwamish Head and Luna Park. That's a whole story in itself, from 1907 to 1913. It was part of our being the Coney Island of the West. And this, again, is from a photograph. Transportation, I would submit, is probably the domineering force in our lives. It shows, it tells us where to live. Life is transportation. You know, if we stand still and don't do anything, we're dead. We move. And these are main means that we moved, but we don't do it anymore. Wouldn't it be great to have streetcars again?
They're just shipping them out of town.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The engineer that drove this, his daughter walked by when they were working on it.
Yes.
And, sorry. That car number 5 did travel along there.
Streetcars left West Seattle in 1940. A lot of people in West Seattle have been wondering, where's the mural for the last 2 months? We had a mural here, if you go on the blog, you'll see comment after comment that it was the favorite mural of many people. This was called Midnight Call. It was done in dark blue because it was supposed to be late at night. And it was a picture of the old West Seattle firehouse and police station that was situated on this corner where the farmers market used to be. The unique thing about this mural, done by Don Berry, was there was a 3D aspect of it that showed the fire wagon and the horses roaring out on a fire call, and they were in dark blue. it was a gorgeous mural and a very imaginative approach to depicting this, but it deteriorated because of its position as on the south wall, and it also had, I mean, it was a separate structure, so it was not on the wall, and it really became, you know, too far gone in a sense. But again, I'm going to poke at you with some questions. Who determines that something's too far gone? What do we do? Do we recreate it? Do we just say, oh, it was nice and look at photos of it? Are we going to recreate it? Do we need other murals of other topics? These are all questions for a community conversation. But what happened is there's a bit of a family difference of opinion. The next generation of the family that owns this building and the owner of the building in that family just took it down one day. And there no notice to the artist, apparently, and it doesn't exist, even in its dilapidated form. And so what do we do? It was here for 25 years, and now it's gone. Do we recreate it? Is it just, and how do we do it? And how do we fund it? And who pays the majority share? It's and another layer to this mural stuff, I liken it to the Golden Gate Bridge. You know, they didn't just build a bridge and then they let it sit and rot. They paint it every year, and when they get to the end, they start painting over again. Continual maintenance is the answer for murals that you want to keep. This is more of a laissez-faire thing. Some of them have been maintained and redone, some of them have not. Is there a way to herd these cats, to preserve some of these treasures? Or do we move on? And speaking of moving on, turn your head this way. There's another issue illustrated by this mural, which was one of the last ones. I think it was the last one. It was instigated by a man named Warren Lawless, who died a couple of years ago. He was a business leader in our community. His last role was to be the owner of the West Seattle Neighborhood Directories. Remember phone books? But what he was inspired by was the time, the many decades he spent in the press room of the West Seattle Herald on Alaska Street, down the hill, right about where the Jiffy Lube and the, you know, by the Home Street Bank. And Warren is depicted in the up near the top. He's about to grab a stack of newspapers. He has glasses and he's facing to the right. And this is a tribute to the West Seattle Herald. Up at the very top in the middle is Rupert Hamilton. He's the founder of the paper in 1923. And think about it, it's the Roaring Twenties. The word that they used more often than any other, it seems, in those papers was boost. They were always boosting something. Things were coming alive in West Seattle. Rupert Hamilton was behind a lot of it. He's the one that Hamilton Viewpoint is named after. Bob Grieve forced the city to do that when he was in the state senate. But he died suddenly in 1939, very young, and his assistant publisher, if you will, was Clyde Dunn. Clyde Dunn and his wife are depicted from a photo down in the lower right-hand corner. But look what's happened to Clyde. Graffiti. Again, serious questions here. Back in 25 years ago, they didn't have the sophistication of chemicals to clean a mural, but is it possible to clean that off? Do you repaint over it? Do you recreate it? There's also the element, the reason that you don't see this in the media is that there is sort of a compact in the media to follow the police advice, which is, you do not picture graffiti because it only encourages more graffiti. And you don't want to encourage more graffiti. But what do we do about this? It's been this way for quite a while. Let's go to a more blatant example, and that's this next mural here, and that has some uniqueness as well. Come on along. Okay, I want to start with the good things about this mural. This is obviously the biggest mural of all. It's the biggest scope in terms of its content, but it also is just physically the largest mural. And I loved watching this mural come to life. Bonnie can confirm this. This is the Dafford brothers, and they come from New Orleans. near New Orleans in Louisiana. One of them was the artist and the other was sort of the administrator. But imagine, most of these murals were done by one artist, one person, but there were two guys here. And sometimes you'd come by during the month or two that they were working and they'd be arguing with each other about what should happen. And it made it entertaining, but it also made it, you were kind of a fly on the wall to the process. The other thing I want you to know about this is that this is the only mural that was created totally freehand.
That's right.
This was not projected from a photo. Imagine, look at the scope of this, look at the perspective, look how he got it right. Freehand. It's incredible. This is what Earl Cruzan talked about when he said world-class muralist. This is obviously the view that on the eastern slope of Pigeon Point, or what we call the West Duwamish Greenbelt now, looking across at a time when it's hard to imagine it today. Today we look out there and we see a widened, deepened, broadened, straightened Duwamish River, and we see Harbor Island, the largest human-made island in the world. But this is when the mouth of the Duwamish was a swamp. It was a bunch of mud flats, and they were building one of the first bridges here. And you can see instantly why West Seattle is seen by the rest of the world as a separate place. If most of you live in West Seattle, and I guarantee you that the people outside do not say to you, "Oh, you live in West Seattle." They say, "You live way over in West Seattle. Take a look."
They would stand with Moen and Robert.
Mo and Robert Dafford.
The brother.
Yes.
Robert, yeah, would stand on scaffolding.
Yes.
And Robert would stand, Douglas, one of them, would stand back here with the picture and he'd say, "Okay, put a mark. No, go a little higher, go a little higher." And they'd put a swash. And that's how they got the lines for the train tracks.
Yep.
And both ends of the painting were not on the picture at all. It's all done.
They were there to provide perspective.
Right.
And what they do is they allow you to kind of lean in, and it's like they're framing the thing. Now, the downside, the graffiti once again.
Yeah.
I've heard people say, "Let's just cover that part up because cleaning it up is going to be impossible." They've tried taking some edges of it off. But it's a, do you recreate? Do you repair? And I can tell you, that's not the only issue with this mural. This is a highly faded version of the original. It was always yellowish and brownish, but it is faded. Let's move on. For the sake of your experience, I ask you to walk in halftime. Walk slowly and keep your eye on the mural and see what happens. Is anybody here an expert in single point or double point perspective? Keep walking, keep looking at the mural. This is the one that changes as you change your perspective on it. It is really eerie and really cool at the same time. This is an ingenious mural by Eric Groey. First of all, it has a frame around it.
The dot that's right there?
Yes.
Right above the guy's hat.
The dot above the guy's hat is the point of perspective.
And everything else is going out this way.
So we are framed, and he painted this in 1989. So he created a faux frame that's 1889. This really isn't 1889 in the photo. Or in the mural. But what you need to know about this, stay where you are, and I will show you where you can see the now version of it.
In the middle of the street.
If you stand right here, go out in the middle of the street, you can do this.
Oh. Yeah.
This is the junction as you're looking north.
That's true.
And remember, I've talked about our landmarking, and we are going at my button here, that we love the junction. They're only a buck. The red building here is the Campbell Building, 1918. And the tan building is the Ham Building, 1926. Easy Street Records is in that. Cupcake Royale is in that. is, you can really see the then and now of how things have grown and changed. And there's a secret here that many of you may not know. There's a woman in the left corner providing perspective outside the frame, and she's standing there holding an umbrella. Very appropriate for right now. But the overgrowth, you cannot see the umbrella for the overgrowth.
She also stands down on Long Beach.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yes. And you can see that the bushes have gone up and they're starting to cover up the car. So this is just an ingenious mural. And it never, it's so simple, but it never fails to fascinate as you come by here. And then when we walk north, take a look at the northern view and remember this view as we're walking north. We're moving on. With the questions I've been asking you, it is only symbolic that the last mural I show you is framed by garbage dumpsters.
Oh, and graffiti on this one too.
This is a depiction of the one of the mosquito fleet boats. Remember the mosquito fleet? Does anybody know how the mosquito fleet was named?
They were so many, they were buzzing all over the sound.
They were buzzing all over the sound, and
they sucked the blood out of people.
They sucked the blood out of people? I like that too. There are a number of explanations. The one I like the best is, think of a mud puddle, and think of a mosquito going around on the mud puddle. Does a mosquito go back and forth like a fairy? No. It bounces all over the place. And these routes went all over Puget Sound. They had regular routes, but they also, in a moment's notice, would change depending on the demand. And if you had a sky-high view looking down, you would think that they were a bunch of mosquitoes. This is off of Beach Drive. This is the only mural that was created by a woman. This is Susan Took, T-O-O-K-E.
Nova Scotia.
From Nova Scotia. And this was drawn from a photograph, and the photo ended on the left right here. So she felt she had to finish the person, and so she put her son's face on there. Again, we have the graffiti issue. This is one of the murals that's on a surface that is not on the wall, it's attached to the wall. And
does that make it easier or harder to repair?
Does it make it easier or harder to repair? It depends on whether you're repairing or restoring. And that may seem like the same thing, but it is not. It certainly is not in terms of how much money it costs. We have now seen all of the murals that exist in the junction. There are three we haven't seen, though. The one that I pointed out, the Midnight Call. Then there was one further about 7 blocks down on Fauntleroy where the old Hewling Brothers was. And that has a depiction of Alki Beach looking from the Admiral Bluff with a woman painting it in the foreground, having stepped out of an old car. The photo, coincidentally enough, came from my mom's photo album. But there was no old car in the photo, and there was no woman painting. But because it was Hewling Brothers, they wanted a car in the mural.
And it was a Buick,
and,
right?
Yes. And that is now dust. It had faded almost beyond recognition, being on the east wall. It was on a porous concrete, you know, blocks of concrete wall. And when they decided to do this development, it's called the Whitaker down there in the triangle, we contacted them about what can we do to preserve the mural in some fashion. Do you want to preserve a faded mural? Or would it be even better to get a brand new one? They agreed to recreate it on a west wall within their project, and you'll see that go up here in the next year or two. And so that will rise again.
Not the same picture.
The same picture.
From the digital.
Yes.
Yeah.
The other mural we aren't seeing is down in Morgan Junction. It's the Morgan Street Market. And it's on the back of the now Starbucks building, used to be Olson's Drug. And it depicts Morgan Street Market from the 30s from a photograph. It is faded, it is peeling. The owner of the business called Peel and Press Dan Austin is working with the building owner and others to try to restore or repair that mural, depending on the amount of money you get. That's an individual example of somebody trying to do something with it. But each one of these murals has issues. Each owner is a different breed of cat. Do we coordinate them all? Do we care as a community? How are we going to do this? I hope that this provokes some thought in you. And if you want to get more involved, we'll be involved. You can get involved with our organization. If you know people who would like to invest in this and keep it going as an ongoing maintenance, like the Golden Gate Bridge, please bring that to mind. Are there any other questions? You've been very patient listening to me. Yeah.
I was just going to ask you, what I didn't understand, where all the murals were housed under some organization. They aren't. Well, they were never really done together.
There was one person who was the Pied Piper who raised money from the building owners and others to get them up. And this is the gift we are left with. And it's a challenge of a gift.
So there wasn't any memorialization of the understandings among people?
Bonnie can confirm this. A lot of this was handshake deals.
Yes.
It was business and building owners willing to say, yeah, I'll do that. This is good for the junction. This is good for West Seattle. So a lot of questions here, not a lot of answers. I hope that you're thinking, if you have great ideas, if you have other people you want to bring into this, let me know.
So do you have some cards for people that don't know how to get in touch with you?
I have lots of business cards. Thank you all for coming. We can go up to Hotwire again, and I'm happy to talk with you on the way, but we're pretty much done with the tour part. You've been very patient.
Thank you.
Thank you for doing this.
That are trying to be this one right here.